Nu ska jag be att få presentera en Stora journalistprisvinnare från 1991. Hon har träffat fler av världens stora personligheter än någon annan svensk journalist. Och det kanske är för att hon själv är en stor tv-personlighet. Men den hon möter idag är mer än bara ett intervjuoffer. Välkommen Stina Dabrowski.
Ja, hans pappa jobbade i gruvan. Själv slutade han skolan vid 16 års ålder och började jobba som cyklande lokalreporter. Men han har också varit krigskorrespondent. Han har skrivit många hundra sportkröniker och han har gjort massor med radioprogram. Men vi känner honom som the king of chat, the man who's met them all. På grund av sina mer än 1000 intervjuer med celebriteter. Välkommen! Michael Parkinson!
Thank you.
Welcome, Michael.
Thank you.
When you were working at 16 as a local reporter on your bike, you had a role model who was Humphrey Bogart.
Movies.
Why was that?
Hollywood movies informed my life. I knew what the New York skyline looked like before I knew what London looked like.
Yeah.
I knew how New York cabbies talked before I knew how a London taxi driver talked. I used to go to the movies four nights a week. I imagine one day I'd marry a film star. And I got my ambition for being a reporter from those movies. Humphrey Bogart was a very glamorous figure. He wore the trilby hat, the snap brim, and the belted raincoat. And when I was 16, I bought myself both of those things. Mm-hmm. And I bought myself a bike, and I used to cycle around the pit villages. The only problem was, when I was going downhill into a wind, the trilby would fly off. Mm-hmm. So I got elastic, and I was the only man in the world with a trilby with elastic on it. And it was fantasy, but the thing about it was that I'd imagined it was a far more glamorous job than it was, as I think all of us do when we go into it. And what you discover very soon, and what you overcome if you want to really to do it, is that it's not that. And somebody was saying earlier, that wonderful lady who won the award there for the radio, I was very taken by what she was saying. A lot of it's boring, what we do. Mm-hmm. And yet it's still, in my view, the best job in the world.
But you wanted, at that early age, you wanted to interview celebrities.
Well, not really. I mean, I wanted to interview film stars. I said I wanted to marry one. I thought that might be the easiest way of getting to know one. and it nearly happened on a couple of occasions. But I although the ladies didn't know what I was after. But I just was in love with the entire notion of actually being a reporter, of being allowed into places, of being into exciting places, like as a war correspondent. I was a very frightened war correspondent. Mm-hmm. Most war correspondents are. The good ones conquer their fear. Mm-hmm. I couldn't. Mm-hmm. In the Congo, for instance, I used to sleep in a bath because I was on the second floor, and downstairs the mercenaries would gather. It was like Dodge City. Mm-hmm. And they fire their revolvers through the... And I thought, I'm going to get shot in the arse. Mm-hmm. So I used to sleep in this in this bath. And I thought... Ernest Hemingway never did that. So, but you know, all of it adds up to something, a whole in the end. Mm. And I've been very lucky in that I've had this huge kind of long career, but also a very varied career. I've done most of the things that you imagine you want to do as a journalist.
Yeah, you really have. And you've come a very long way from your background, because your dad worked in the mines, a very, very tough job.
Yes.
And he took you down once, and what did he say to you?
He took me down the pit when I was 14, and he took me not into the tourist area, he took me to where men worked, some on their knees or their bellies in very low, dangerous seams. And I was frightened again. I mean, you're a mile down, you know, and it's the heat, and you see these men working more or less naked, getting coal out, you know. And when we took me home, we said nothing at all. And he walked to the gate of my house, and he said, "What do you think?" Mm-hmm. And I said, "What I think is I would not do that for £100 a day." Mm-hmm. And he said, "That's what I wanted to hear you say. Mm-hmm. But if ever," he said, "I see you at the pit gates, I'll kick your backside all the way home." Mm. And I say in my book, so I start my book, this is the story of a boy who did as he was told.
Yeah. But you didn't always, did you?
No.
No.
Or did as I was told.
Yeah. But you obeyed your father. You didn't go down the pit. You learned the difficult trick of talking to brick walls. And you got a very tough lesson from Orson Welles.
Well, Orson Welles was, when we started the talk show, the BBC, we had to convince the industry that we were serious, but we were worthwhile in a sense. And at that time, we're now talking about 1970, the greatest star, the most impressive man in the world was Orson Welles, in the entertainment sense. And he was the key, and we knew that if we could persuade him to actually come on our show, it would open up for the rest, and he did. We eventually, by all kinds of extraordinary methods, we got him on the show. And I shall also remember, I was terrified. I spent a week trying to get the questions in, and there they were on my desk. There was a knock on the door, and I opened the door, and there was this huge man blocking out the daylight, entirely dressed in black, black sombrero, black tie, black shirt, black cloak, swept into the room past me, put the cloak, looked around and said, looking at my desk, said, "What are they?" And I said, they're my questions, sir. He said, "May I look?" And I said, "Yes." So he picked them up like this and like that. And he said, "How many talk shows have you done?" And I said, "About 5 so far, sir." He said, "I've done rather more than you. Let's burn these and talk." Mm-hmm. And that's what we did. I mean, we went on. But see, Welles could do that. Mm. And from that moment on, we were established. From that moment on, everybody wanted to be on the show, because if Welles gave it his the credibility, then the rest followed. Mm-hmm. He was an amazing man.
But how, I mean, you have managed to create an atmosphere in the studio that no one else has. I mean,
well, I don't know about that, but I mean,
yeah, but how do you do that?
Well, it's about what we're talking about earlier. Any journalist here will know that any journalist worth his or her salt has got to learn how to relate. You have to have an empathy. You're doing it now. You're nodding, mm-hmm. and you're looking at me. And that's terribly important to settle down. And you know as well as I know that the great problem of interviewing on television in a talk show with a band playing and all the lights mm-hmm. and a microphone in every orifice is to actually convince people that it's not like that, really. There's just the two of you mm-hmm. in the entire mm-hmm. universe. Mm-hmm. And that's what you have to do. And I've always thought that in the first 2 minutes of any interview I ever did, and I don't care who it was with, Muhammad Ali or Orson Welles or whoever it might be, you could see in their eyes an uncertainty, mm-hmm. sometimes a fear, mm-hmm. which you had to get rid of mm-hmm. if you were to have that consensual relationship.
Mm-hmm. But how do you do that?
Well, I don't know.
You don't
I've
know.
Got no idea.
You learned the trick, well, but you can't teach it.
I mean, I've lectured, I've talked to policemen about the way they mm-hmm. conduct interviews, mm-hmm. detectives and people like that. And they're just very simple things. It's about body language. It's about mm-hmm. not doing this. It's mm-hmm. about not leaning back. Mm-hmm. It's about being open and that sort mm-hmm. of thing. But in the end, if you haven't got that, and I think it's a kind of mystical, but there's something that you learn how to do over the years quite naturally. Mm, and if you don't...
Not everybody.
No, if you don't, you're lost.
What about preparations?
Well, again, I mean, the key to all of it is preparation. I reckon that I would go in knowing more about them that they probably knew about themselves. Mm. But I might only use 10% of that. Mm-hmm. But you had mm-hmm. to have it there just in case things went wrong.
Mm-hmm. I talked to somebody the other day who said, well, Parkinson, he just sits there, you know, because everything is prepared with the guest. You know, they know which stories they're going to tell, and he just sits there and looks happy.
Is that person in this room?
He didn't want me to mention his name.
I'm sure. But he's wrong. And you can't, the thing you can't do with an interview, you cannot rehearse an interview. It doesn't work.
They do in the States, don't
no,
they?
No, they have script writers in the mm-hmm. States, but that's more for the interviewer, is more often mm-hmm. than not a comedian, to actually steer the conversation into an area where he has a written response. That's part of written that, and sometimes the guests partake in that deceit, but with a conversational talk show you can't do that at all. I mean, you have to. And the only question meeting people beforehand is the other question. People think that you sit down and talk it through them. Well, you don't. You can't do that. And I only actually ask one question, and that's I meet somebody. I say, "Is there anything you don't want mm-hmm. to talk about?" Mm-hmm. And they will say yes or no. And if they say yes, I say, "What is that?" Then you make a judgment. I mean, Rex Harrison said to me, "I don't want to talk about my wife's." And I said,
well, you had like eight.
Well, I said to him, I said, you've had eight. Yeah. It'll leave a big gap in the conversation. and he said, maybe. And we talked about his wives. Woody Allen did not want to talk about his affair with his daughter-in-law. Mm. But I would not have felt that justified had it not been for the fact that as a journalist, you could not ignore the fact that that relationship didn't destroy his career, but seriously affected his career. Middle America wouldn't go to his movies. So there was a justification, an editorial justification, if you like, to ask that question, which was not prurient. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's the way you do it.
I asked you before, didn't I?
What?
I asked you, is there a question you don't want to answer?
You asked me that, you did.
But there were none.
No, at all.
So I will go on.
I'm putting your hands.
Total freedom.
I will confess to anything.
You say that a talk show is an unnatural act between two consenting adults in public. Sounds almost dirty to
me. Well, it is really.
But what happens if one of them doesn't give her consent?
You're talking about Meg Ryan now.
Of course. I am. Everybody wants to hear.
I mean, then there's nothing you can do. But what you have to understand, this is the other thing that leaks into the talk show as such. You have to understand when you're doing a talk show, it is an interview, but it's an entertainment at the same time. And I was defined doing a talk show as interviewing while tap dancing. And that's really what it's about. And so therefore, when something like Meg Ryan happens in a normal interview.
So what did happen?
I don't know. I don't know why she was.
She was very like.
She didn't want to marry
hostile.
Me. No, she
how many did actually?
There's a good several. There's an antipathy. Shirley MacLaine, that was the nearest I got to actually on air conducting some kind of
affair. Tell them what she said about you.
Well, she was a terrible, terrible flirt, and I was flirting too with her. Mm-hmm. And at one point, she sort of looked at me and said, "Your button's undone." She shoved her finger into my belly button and started turning it around like that. And the button was undone, and she looked at me, and I was very discomforted and went red. And she said, "We pop them off, and the wives sew them back on." Meg Ryan. So I don't know what was wrong with her. I mean, there was something wrong with her. She didn't like being where she was. She didn't like me. She didn't like anybody who was on the show, and she wanted out. And when I asked her, you know, if you were, what would you do? You've been a journalist. She said, "Wrap it up." And I thought in that moment, that's precisely what I should do. But then I thought, no, we'll go fishing, because I understood. I hope that what the audience love is to see the host discomfited. Mm. They want to see the host squirm. Mm-hmm. It's called kill the quarterback. Yeah. And that's really basically part of doing the talk show. You only ever remember for that. Mm.
But you've been through such discomfort very, very few times.
Oh, yeah, well, no, yes. But enough to mark me for life.
Yeah. but do you think, did you do anything wrong with Meg Ryan?
Yes, I booked her on the show. That was wrong.
But you booked another one on the show that I was really very, very curious to see, because I interviewed her, a lot of journalists here probably did, or some anyway, and she is an ice queen. She is extremely difficult. And when I saw her, Madonna, in your show, she was like a purring kitten. Mm, well, she was happy, she was warm-hearted, she was witty. What did you do with her?
Well, it was interesting. We tried for 20 years to get Meg Ryan. And what we don't do on the show, never have done.
Madonna, you mean?
Madonna. I'm sorry, I'm obsessed by Meg Ryan. It's a terrible condition, isn't it? It really is. Go to my grave, Meg Ryan. But what we don't do on the show, we disregard any conditions placed on the interview by agents or PR people. We always have done, we always will do, which is the reason why we never interviewed Barbara Streisand, because there were too many preconditions. And for 20 years, we tried to get Madonna, and the preconditions were such that we said no. I mean, until you actually say, look, they should deliver, we trust you, let's do the show properly, then we won't do it. So 20 years on, and she did it. Mm. And I wonder what the fuss was about. I mean, she was wonderful.
Why was she wonderful?
She was just, I thought, fascinating person. I mean, she is who she is.
But was it because she thought, this surrounding fits me, this is good for me? Whilst in other interviews,
I think she'd arrived at a time in her life, in her career, where she felt confident enough to go out and be herself and talk about herself. And often, you know, and you would know this too, that people in this room would know this, these people are protected. Mm. by people who protect them because they have nothing else to do. Mm-hmm. And often the person who's being protected has got no idea what's going on.
Because when you
get to them, you find that they're fine. They're extraordinary. Jennifer Lopez, you know, the entire suite of dressing room at the BBC was covered in white damask and silk, and Nubian slaves were wandering around.
Who's the most amazing person you ever talked to?
You're not interested in, are you? I was. Who's the most interesting person? Yeah. Well, it's very difficult because...
No, amazing.
I mean Muhammad Ali.
Muhammad Ali.
Yeah.
Do you remember a comment he made about your looks?
He said, "You ain't as dumb as you look," is what he said. But he said that to everybody.
Yes, because he said that to me, you know, many years ago. And I was really concerned about that for a long time.
Really?
And then I read in your book that he said that to you too.
How vain of you. But I was very lucky because I started the talk show in 1970 when he sort of returned to the ring. Mm. And I finished the first episode of a talk show in 82 as he was retiring. And the four or five interviews I did with him, which are all long one-hour interviews, more or less sadly chart the decline of him. As a man, I mean, mentally too. You see, in the last episode, you see the illness that robbed him of his personality, and that now has left him in this terrible state where he's kept alive by medicine, and he's a shambling wreck of that great and glorious athlete. In 1971, when he walked down the stairs of my show, I'd never seen anybody like this man. He was beautiful, and I used the word advisedly, and he had the most beautiful hands. He had very long, tapering fingers that belonged not to a prize fighter, but to a musician. And he was funny and witty and all those things. And then the black Muslim came in 3 years later, and he changed then. And then the gradual decline until they say, in the 80s, it's the saddest thing of all. And that's the problem, that if you stick around in a job for too long, you see things that you admire and love decline.
But you stopped your job before that happened, didn't you?
Before I declined? No, I don't know about that. I'd had enough. You know, I've been in television 50 years. So I was at the very beginning of television to the end. I'm talking But therefore, what you do, if you do that, is you actually, you go through substantial change. And you might arrive at a point in your life, in your career, where you don't enjoy it anymore as much as you used to. So instead of being that boring old man in the corner complaining about everything, go, leave. I mean, what more do you want from it?
You know? So you wrote a biography about your life.
Yes.
What was the most painful thing with writing that book?
Writing it? Well, it was...
I mean, what was the most painful thing to kind of go through again?
To go through again? I don't know. I haven't had many bad times in my life. I really haven't. I mean, I've been so lucky. There was nothing that was painful at all. The death of my mother was painful. The death of my father, the death of parents is painful because you have to deal with guilt as well as grief. But that would be the only sad part of the book. The rest has been, we're all who work in this game, we're lucky. I mean, we really are.
Did you get any new insights?
Into what, to myself?
Yes.
Two things I never understood. I never understood how many jobs I'd had until I went back and went over.
Impressive.
It's not impressive, it's just a lot. It's like a vagrant going from town to town. And the other thing that I'd never quite realized, and it was a very important lesson, was how many old people or older people I'd sought out in my life for information, mentors, in other words. And I think that's something now that maybe that we're losing. You know, we're getting rid of people too soon. And I think that old, experienced people, no matter what area of life, have got an awful lot to offer. They certainly did to me. I went to them because I reckoned that they knew something I didn't.
And what about your wife?
What about my wife?
Yes, didn't you get any new insight about your wife writing the book?
Did about Mary? The only insight I got about Mary was I don't know how she stayed with me all those years. Basically, we'll be married 50 years this coming year, next year, and it's a warm feeling. I've got three very, very attractive boys and their wives and eight grandchildren. And all the boys work with me now in one way or another. So we're kind of like a little nuclear powerhouse there. But, you know, it's as I said, I just, it was just when I read the book, I thought, what a lucky man you've been, basically.
Yeah. And what she has contributed quite a lot, hasn't she? I mean, she gave up her own career in television.
Well, she was a very, very good interviewer, Mary. She was a teacher, and then she became an interviewer. And she worked with me on a show, an afternoon show, the first afternoon talk show. And she was a fierce interviewer. I mean, there was one moment where I was in the studio, it was a live show, and I was sitting next to a man called Timothy Raisin, who was a minister in the Tory government. And Mrs. Thatcher, who was then in the health department, had decided that she'd get rid of school milk, free school milk.
Yeah, we will remember.
This really, really upset Mary, who'd been a teacher. They sent along some junior minister to defend the position, and Mary made mincemeat of him in the studio. I sat there, and she very cleverly, very forensically, never losing her temper properly, she skillfully demolished every argument he had until he had nothing to say. He was open-mouthed looking at her, and as she did this wonderful demolition job, and I was so proud of her, Timothy Raisin turned to me and said, "Did you see that?" I said, "I did." He said, "By God," he said, "I'd hate to be married to her."
But the funny thing is that you, the master, Sir Michael Parkinson, the master of questioning, you didn't have the guts to put the question to her to ask her out the first time.
When I first met her? Yes. Well, no, I was shy. I still am. Somebody was saying earlier that they were shy. And I think that's true. A lot of journalists I know are shy. But overcome it in a professional sense. And I was shy of Mary, this wonderful looking girl who came on the bus. And so I got a friend of mine to date her, and I turned up. And she didn't run away, so that was it. That was all right.
Yeah. And what about future?
I've been sort of going around sort of selling the book and a double CD and things like that. Then we've got 800 shows with some of the greatest names of the 20th and 21st century. There's an extraordinary catalogue. The problem is now is how do we use that? And next year we're doing a double DVD of the best of Parkinson. And then all sorts of things. Maybe it's the internet. Maybe it's the website. Maybe I don't know where you're going now. That's a fascinating thing about television now, isn't it? About the media. I mean, I wish I had longer to go, because I think the next 10 years is going to be really, really fascinating.
We are living in very, very exciting times when it comes to television. Thank you very much, Sir Michael Parkinson.
It is my pleasure.
Pleasure having you here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I get on there? Yeah.
Thank you so much, Sir Michael. Och tack, Stina. Det var ett verkligt mästarmöte. Kvällens sista pris är Lukas Bonniers stora journalistpris. Låt oss höra vad juryn har tänkt.
Jag är alltså ordförande för Lukas Bonnierpriset, och det ger man då till en person som inte liksom går bara riktigt in i de här kriterierna med berättare, förnyare eller avslöjare, utan har för en hel journalistisk gärning.
Blir det lättare eller svårare med åren?
Man hittar ju tekniker så att man vet hur man går tillväga rent metodiskt. Men när det gäller just Lukas Bonnier-priset så är det ett pris som vi många engagerar sig. Hela juryn engagerar sig väldigt mycket i det, så det kan bli väldigt, väldigt livliga diskussioner.
Det verkar som att du tycker det är kul.
Hur roligt.
Precis som sig bör var det tidningsnästorn Gustav von Platen som blev första mottagare av det efterlängtade karriärpris som instiftades 1992 för långvarig, framstående journalistisk yrkesprestation. Von Platen har följts av en lång rad ärkepublicister som alla kunnat kröna karriären med Lukas Bonniers stora journalistpris.
Lägg ut! Lägg ut! Lägg ut! Lägg ut! Lägg ut!
Välkommen upp, Maria Schotenius och Carl-Johan Bonnier. Carl-Johan, har du någonting du skulle vilja tillägga om Lukas Bonniers pris?
Jag har nog hört det mesta, men innan det blev Lukas Bonniers pris så saknade vi ett sånt här pris. Det kallades för Jolo-priset under många år. För Jolo var ett bra exempel på någon som alltid var bra hela tiden, men inte passade in i de dåvarande priskategorierna. Och till slut så instiftades då det här priset som inte relaterade till någon aktuell insats under det senaste året. Och vi ser på vägen här här är nu alla pristagande, det var 16 år det instiftades och det finns ett absolut behov av det. Och nu undrar vi, Maria, vem som ska sitta där på porträttet nästa år?
Lukas Bonniers stora journalistpris går till en person som, för att hon som uppskattad reporter, redigerare och chef under decennier och i ett antal medier drivit den journalistiska utvecklingen framåt med känsla, skärpa och en stark formuleringsförmåga. Lukas Bonniers stora journalistpris går till Karen Söderberg.
Karen, grattis. Kom till mikrofonen. Hur känns det här?
Alltså jag är mest häpen över att de inte sa ett annat namn när du var. Eftersom jag ändå har vetat det ett par dagar.
Hur är det för att stå i rampljuset så här? Du är en person som gärna håller i bakgrunden.
Ja, det är inte min bästa gren.
Men vilken är din bästa gren? Du har så många.
Jag tror att det kanske är att leka och så kanske hantverket. Kanske.
Du har som Sir Michael Parkinson haft en lång karriär med väldigt många olika jobb och roller. Om du skulle själv
beskriva... Vad var det du sa? Lång och trogen tjänst.
Ja, det var ett litet slip där, men trogen tjänst till yrket i alla fall. Om du skulle beskriva din långa karriär väldigt kort, hur skulle det då låta?
Ja, det var väl ungefär vad ni sa. Jag har varit redigerare, olika kvarts- och halvchefer och reporter på olika ställen.
Och sen har du hoppat mellan tidningar, medier och journalistroller.
Ja.
Vad har du trivs bäst? Vilken roll har du trivs bäst?
Alltså jag har nog bäst trivts med hoppandet eftersom man kan väl säga att det ena... Alltså man lär sig mycket om att skriva om man är på tv till exempel. Så att det är väl just hoppandet. Det är väldigt konstigt att inte se någon.
Ja, du ser ju mig, Karin.
Ja, jag ser ju det.
Räcker inte det just nu?
Jo, det räcker.
Härligt. Säg mig, du var nämligen stjärnskribent på Dagens Nyheter.
Nej, jag var reporter.
Ja. Vi som läste dig tyckte att du var en stjärnskribent. Och så hoppade du till tv. Varför gjorde du det?
Därför att det verkade roligt. Därför att de frågade mig. Och tv var väldigt roligt.
Ja. Vad lärde du ut av just det? Att plötsligt byta medier?
Jag lärde mig ju att tänka tvärtom, för utan bilder ingen tv, det är självklart. Men utan bilder kanske inte riktigt något skrivande heller. Så att, och så logistiken, den var ju mycket värre då förstår jag. Men det här att förbereda sig, planera, tänka, göra, allt det där.
Du, juryn väljer att lyfta fram att du har varit en fantastisk chef. Uppskattad chef tror jag att de säger. Hur är det att vara chef för journalister?
Åh, det bäst. Alltså det här att göra tillsammans när det faktiskt blir mycket bättre därför att man gör det ihop. Det är roligt.
Ja, det låter romantiskt för att
det kanske är
väldigt väldigt många tycker att journalister är väldigt svåra att vara chefer för. Du har själv skrivit faktiskt riktiga journalister behöver inga chefer.
Ja, men jag citerade faktiskt Bobby Sorander som sa det. Det var inte jag som sa det.
Okej, men essensen i att vara chef för journalister har du också själv jämfört med att vara chef för ett operahus med väldigt många starka individualister?
Ja, så är det ju. Och det är ju också så att det är ju inte operachefen eller för den delen chefen på en redaktion som har mest status. Det är ju faktiskt hantverkarna. Det är ju skrivarna och redigerarna, de som gör det.
Det är inte fint att vara chef på. För...
Jo, men det är inte... Det är ju i vår egen lilla självupptagna värld så är det nog ändå den fantastiska redigeraren, den jättebra skrivaren, den påhittiga. Det kan ju vara en chef också.
Och vad är det som driver oss journalister?
Alltså de flesta jag har haft med att göra, de drivs av att de är i ett yrke som de tycker är viktigt på riktigt. De drivs av att vilja berätta, vilja göra, vilja kommunicera.
Mm. Alltså, det som har drivit dig?
Det som har drivit mig? Alltså jag tycker ju att världen är gåtfull. Jag tycker människorna är gåtfulla. Och inte har det blivit bättre heller med tiden. Alltså det är för att förstå hur det hänger ihop. Mm. Det är det.
Du har ofta kallats en spejare i framtiden. Vad ser du när du spejar in i framtiden?
Samma som alla andra, man vet inte.
Man vet inte.
Men man vet inte, det är det som är spännande.
Varför vill du aldrig bli chefredaktör?
Alltså det är inte min grej, då skulle man stå så här för jämnan. Och det är helt enkelt inte det jag tycker är roligt.
Istället blev det en massa andra. Senast var det Korre i Köpenhamn. Och du är själv född i Danmark. Känns det som att komma hem?
Nej, det kan man väl inte säga. Men det är klart att det är ett... Alltså när jag kom till det jobbet, då var det ju så att jag fick ju lära mig politik och ekonomi och allt sånt där som vem som helst annan hade fått göra. Men det är klart att det är speciellt att återvända till sitt första språk. Det är speciellt att återvända till... Alltså det är nästan som madeleinekaka när man går in i en trappuppgång och så doftar det som i ens farmors trapp. Och sen är det ju så att jag vet ju något om danska seder och danska sätt att vara. Så på det viset var det en förmån och roligt.
Du är den enda här ikväll som har haft möjlighet att fundera på vad du skulle göra med, vad du kan göra med pengarna. Har du kommit fram till
det? Jag visste ju att du skulle fråga om det. Och när han frågade första gången, för han förberedde, då sa jag att jag kanske ska ha en ny cykel. Då sa han, det är tråkigt. Alltså du får vara lite rolig. Ja. Så jag hade tänkt att jag skulle säga, jag har hört att Patagonien har en märkvärdig skärgård.
Det låter löftesrikt. Tack, Karin. Stort grattis. Tack Maria och tack Carl-Johan också. Och medan fotoblixtarna viner runt Karin så ska jag be oss tacka för oss här. Det var allt från Stora Journalistpriset från utdelningen. För kvällen har just börjat. Middagen står serverad där ute. Och eftermiddagen så möts vi här igen. Då öppnar vinnarna och de nominerade sina egna barer. Årets vinnare ber jag komma fram för den klassiska vinnarbilden. Till er alla säger jag stort tack, till alla medverkande, till alla gäster och stort tack för mig också.
And And it makes me feel quite small that you're the one I love the most of all.
Inside.